Welcome to Free Christian Church of God's video outreach ministry, bringing the gospel message of Jesus Christ into your home each and every Sunday morning. If you would like more information about the video ministry or other ministries that we have to offer, stay tuned immediately following this program. And now, open your Bibles and follow along as we bring you today's message.
Philippians chapter 3. Lift your Bible in the air before we read it. Say it with me. This is my Bible. It's God's infallible word. I am who it says I am. I have what it says I have. And I can do what it says I can do. Today I'll be taught the word of God. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the word of God. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. And I'll never be the same in Jesus' name. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. I want to know Christ in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain the resurrection from the dead. God, I pray that your words will come alive to us today. Lord, I believe that the message is always yours. God, this is your pulpit, it is your church, you own it all. And God, I believe that it is yours, I know that it is yours, because I know it's not mine. Father, I pray that your anointing will be all over it today. God, I pray for results today. Father, so often we preach a message and it falls on deaf ears. But God, I pray that today's message will run deep. And God, that we'll truly look at ourselves. We'll truly look at our relationship with you. And God, we'll judge ourselves according to the word we hear today to see if we are right with you. Bless this time together, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Wouldn't it be horrible if we meet together here every Sunday, all of these people show up for church, and then come eternity, some of y'all don't make it. Wouldn't it be terrible? What an awful waste of our time. What an awful waste of our opportunities to come into the church, to hear the word of God, to hear God's message preached, to hear it taught, and then go home and absolutely don't get it. Wednesday, Jimmy came into my office. He always says that when I'm studying, so he can bother me. He come into my office and he has some books in his hand. He's taking systematic theology classes, which if you don't know what systematic theology is, it's heavy duty stuff. It will give you a headache. It is deep, deep, deep stuff. And I went through systematic theology 1, systematic theology 2, many, many hundreds of years ago when I was in college. But he's taking this class and I could tell that he was lit up by something. And he comes in and he starts explaining it to me. He starts reading to me out of his book and telling me these things. And he said, Dad, you know, you have to know and understand all of this before you can deal with anything else. It was like a great light went off in his mind and he suddenly understood the Bible in a way that he had never understood the Bible before. Yes, I shouted. And then I leaped from my chair and I jumped across my desk and I grabbed him around the neck and we rolled on the floor joyously laughing with one another. Well, at least in my mind, we did. There's some things that you have to understand before you can understand anything else. Christianity has become a great mystery to many people because they're lacking in the fundamentals. They don't know what God wants them to know. There are basic truths that elude them because they have either not been taught those truths or they simply don't want to learn. One of those truths is what it means to be a born-again Christian. There are many, many people today who call themselves a Christian, who believe that they are a Christian, who in reality have no idea what that means. Being a Christian is a personal relationship with Jesus. It's not just attending church services. It's not just being a good person. It's not just being religious or having some religious experience. And it's not even repentance and the confession of your sin. But being a Christian is an intimate relationship with God. It is a personal bond that is comparable to the relationship of that of a father and his child. Galatians 4:6 says, because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. While all of the names of God are important, the name Abba, Father is one of the most significant names of God when it comes to our understanding of how God relates to those who know him. The word Abba is an Aramaic word that would be most closely translated as daddy. It's a common term that in those days young children used to address their fathers. It signifies the relationship of a father with his child, as well as the childlike trust that that young child puts in his daddy. In Mark 14:36, when Jesus was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane and facing the coming torture of the cross, he prayed, Abba, Father. Everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not my will, but your will be done. In a moment of great conflict, facing the most horrible death sentence ever, Jesus pleaded with the Heavenly Father to spare him from this awful fate. But yet he trusted his Father enough to know that if this indeed was his Father's will, then everything would be okay. Romans 8:15, the Apostle Paul said, the Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again, but rather the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The problem for many professing believers nowadays is that the father-to-child relationship with God does not exist. The intimacy is missing. Sometimes it's missing because they really don't want to be that close to God. But I believe that for many people, that intimate relationship is missing because they're unaware that it is possible to know God in such a way. Many believers have a connection to God, but that connection isn't personal. Their connection to God isn't personal because they don't know God as they should know him. They don't know him as he would like for them to know him. But how can we intimately know a God that we can't see? We can't see God. We can't reach out our hand and touch God. We can't hear God speak to us in an audible voice. So how can we ever intimately know him? There's always been a need for visible expressions and manifestations of unseen spiritual things. We've always needed them to help even the most educated culture and holy people to realize and to recognize our unseen God. God understands that. So God has provided ways for us so we can understand. God is a divine mystery. Our Creator is so far above us and so far beyond us that even the best of us won't ever be able to fully comprehend who he is. His ways are so far above our ways and his thoughts so far above our thoughts that oftentimes, even with our best effort, we can't figure him out. Does God sometimes confuse you? Yes. Thank you for being honest. I'll be honest too. Sometimes God gives me a headache. Amen. Stay with it. Sometimes I will think and I'll try to figure out what God is doing. You ever do this? I'll lay awake in the middle of the night and I'll wonder what God's doing and I'll wonder what I ought to do. And when I finally think that I have it all figured out, God does something totally unexpected. Does God sometimes confuse you? God is a divine mystery, but he's not such a mystery that he cannot be solved. The divine mystery of our unseen God can be solved because God wants it to be solved. God wants to be seen. He wants you and me to know him as he is and not just as we imagine him to be. Our unseen God, who exceeds our greatest imagination, longs for a real relationship with you and me. He desires a one-on-one, intimate, personal bond with us as a father shares with his child. But why would God want that? Why would God want that? God wants a real relationship with every man and every woman that he has ever created. Not just a religious relationship, not just a ritualistic relationship or a part-time church relationship, but God wants a true and honest everyday bond that is based upon love and trust and understanding. But the big problem is many people will take this awesome unseen God and rather than trying to know him, they instead perceive him as they choose to understand him. In their mind, they've carefully created an image of God that makes sense to them. He looks like they think he should look, and he acts like they think he should act. This God of their imagination fits into their life choices. His rules are their rules. His standards are their standards. His morals are their morals. And they are satisfied, key word, satisfied with that. They really don't want to know what the Bible says about God. They really don't want to know what God has said about himself. They're really not interested on how God operates or what he requires of them in return. And many of them get very offended and very defensive when anybody interferes with their handmade, man-made, impersonal God. They don't want to hear that God wants their all. They don't want to hear that God demands complete holiness. A personal God is way too much God for some people. They don't want God to be that big. They don't want God to be that close. They don't want God to be around all of the time. They don't want God in their business. They don't want God in their personal life. So they create in their mind an image of God, and that God that they perceive is like an idol. They take him out of the box on Sunday morning and they dust him off and they set him up on the shelf so that everybody can see. But when Monday rolls around, they take him down from the shelf and they wrap him up and they put him away. On the weekend, they hide him in the closet or they slide him under the bed so he's totally out of sight. But then when they're in trouble, they'll take him out again and they'll pray to him and they'll ask for his help. And then when life is going well again, they intentionally misplace him so he can't be found. They want an idol, not a personal living God. Everything begins with God. Everything that is now or ever has been or ever will be is predicated on who God is. That means that if your perception of God is wrong, then everything else in your life will be wrong. There are some things you have to know before you can understand anything else. How you view God affects every aspect of your life, from the beginning of creation to the end of the world and everything in between. Your family, your health, your joys, your fears, your sorrows are all predicated on your perspective of who God is. But because you don't know God and because you refuse to know God as he wants to be known, you misjudge him. Have you ever been misjudged? I can tell you as a pastor, that happens a lot. Has anybody ever taken you the wrong way? How does that make you feel? How does that make you feel? You're a good person, but somebody thinks that you're not a good person because of something they heard gossiped about you. You work hard, but somebody thinks you're lazy because somebody told a story about you that's not true. You're a loving and caring person, but somebody thinks that you're selfish and unfeeling because of somebody who didn't have all of the facts. How does that make you feel? How do you feel when you have been misjudged? If you've ever been misjudged, then you should have some understanding of how God feels when we misjudge him. But we continue to misjudge God because we really don't know God. We accuse him of not caring. We accuse him of not being involved. We blame him for the problems in our world. We accuse him of not answering our prayers. We doubt his word. We doubt his promises. We get angry when things don't work the way we want them to and when we want them to, forgetting that God has told us that he loves us with an unfathomable love, and given the proper time, all things will work out for the good to those who love and trust him. But we misjudge him. Am I stepping on any toes this morning? I got to tell you, my own feet hurt. Okay? God has told us plainly that he is love. Not that he contains love or that he's capable of loving, but the very definition of love is God himself. John 4:8 says God is love. God has expressed his love to us by sending himself to die on a cross. John 15:13 says, for greater love has no man than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friend. Even when we didn't know God or serve him, Jesus considered us to be his friends, and he laid down his life for us. And yet we continue to misjudge him because we choose not to know him. We think that we know love, but we don't know God. And if our perception of God is wrong, then we really don't know what true love is either. Are you seeing the connection here? There's some things you have to know first if you're going to understand everything else. We hear talk about UFOs. There's a program on every day now, and maybe you've seen it. See, I'm old. I don't watch the networks. I watch some weird channels. It's about ancient aliens, you know, and these guys are on there. The one guy with a big
crazy hair, you know, he's just telling how great this is, you know. We hear talk about these UFOs and these alien beings from outer space who from time to time fly down and study our little planet. Well, some people believe that they visit us in the darkness of night and they capture a few unwitting individuals and then they beam them aboard their spacecraft and they do experiments on them like they're a laboratory animal. Even others entertain the notion that they walk among us in disguise. And they're slowly infiltrating our world so that the opportune moment they can take over our planet. Are there any aliens here this morning? Let me see your hand. I just thought I would ask. Yeah, I'm still a little suspicious. All right. We're told that there's much evidence and that all of it is documented and is known by our government who keeps a secret from the average citizens so they won't incite a panic. You thought being a Christian took faith. Man, it takes a lot more faith than it does to be a Christian. We're told that these alien beings are more intelligent than we are. Why is that? Why is that? Why do we assume that they are smarter than we are? I've never heard anybody who believes in space aliens describe them as total idiots. Have you? Nobody's ever claimed that Dumbo and Ding Dong from Planet Goofy got lost one day and ended up crashing in Roswell, New Mexico. One recent argument I heard was why these super intelligent space aliens don't communicate with us mere human beings was a pretty good one. One gentleman said, if they're so superior in intelligence, then why don't they try to communicate with us and tell us why we're here? The other gentleman responded, he said, you see ants walking on the sidewalk, and you're far more intelligent than those ants. Have you ever tried to communicate with them? That sounds logical. Now, don't go home and lay your head on the sidewalk and start speaking to an ant here, okay? That's not this point. We assume that if God exists, and he is who the Bible describes him to be, this all-seeing, all-knowing, all-powerful God, then there was no reason for him to want to communicate with us or to connect to us. That is the argument of this world. Many people don't even pursue God because they believe that if God does exist, as the Bible describes him, that a relationship with him is out of the question. But the Bible tells us time and time again that God has tried to communicate with us. He's given to us his word to express to you and me his plan for humanity from the beginning to the end. He sent his son to pay the ultimate price for our sin so we can be reconciled to him. He has filled our world with symbolism that describes his nature. Romans chapter 1 tells us that God has revealed himself to all men so that all are without excuse. And yet we've turned a blind eye and a deaf ear to all of the evidence. And that's why we need to come to know God. That's why we need to study his word and fix our misconceptions so we can know our great and mysterious God intimately as he wants to be known. This is where the church comes in. I'm going to tell you right up front, your perception of the church is probably wrong. It's probably wrong. Most of us were raised in a small church. How many of you were raised in a small church? I mean small church, littler than this. Most of us raised in a small church where only a few people made all of the decisions all of the time and where the program rarely ever changed. We are familiar with the small church. We're familiar with filling church leadership positions with anyone and everyone because there are always more positions than there were people. We're used to the casual social approach to ministry. We're used to the church being led by people who aren't really spiritually qualified to do the job. They were just available. I've been in church all of my life, and ever since I was a young boy, I have enjoyed attending church. That's honest to goodness truth. Nobody ever had to make me go to church. I loved the church that I grew up in. It was social. It was fun. We had dinners and concerts and revival meetings, and yes, we did have Bible school. There was a lot of tradition in my little church, and they were good traditions as far as I was concerned. But it wasn't until I was a teenager that something happened in my little country church that opened my eyes to the truth and the reality of who God is. In our little country church, we would have a revival every year. Apparently, over the course of every 12 months, our congregation would die and need to be resurrected. So we had a yearly revival. Now, somehow that doesn't seem like good advertisement for the church to me. I mean, it doesn't. Somebody looking at the church from the outside going, well, it's been another year. Somebody has to revive them again. Church, we should never need revived. We have been brought from death to life. We ought to be the most living people on this planet. It was during our yearly traditional revival meeting when something happened that none of us were expecting. During our yearly traditional revival meeting, a revival broke out. The Holy Spirit descended, God took over, the devil was thrown out, and all of heaven broke loose. We had a real revival. People were getting saved. They were getting truly saved. Bad people were becoming good people. Many had a life-shattering experience. They left their life of sin. They began living in righteousness. And for the first time in my life, I saw the real power of the living God at work in my little country church. The revival went on for 2 weeks. Services would start at 7 o'clock and go until 11 o'clock at night or even later. Nobody wanted to go home. Some people would leave and then they'd come back to the church bringing somebody else with them and they'd go to the altar and pray again. I'd never seen anything like that. I'd been to church my entire life and I had never experienced anything even close to what I was seeing. I had Sunday school pins for perfect attendance. I knew the stories of Adam and Eve and Noah's Ark. But until that time, I knew little or nothing about real salvation. I knew church, but I didn't know God's church. I knew the Melrose Church, but I didn't know God's church. I knew our traditions and our policies, but I didn't know God's church. That's when I realized that I really didn't know God either. Until I met him on the eighth night of that revival meeting. It was then that God went from being somebody that I'd heard stories about to somebody that I really knew. God went from being a symbol that I worshiped to someone that I had a relationship with. That's when God became someone real to me, because there are some things you have to know before you can understand everything else. Unfortunately, we still deal with the same problem today. On Sunday mornings, our church buildings are filled with people who know church, but they don't know God's church. They know traditions and they know rituals, but they know nothing of the church as God has described it in his word. Some of them are unwilling to learn. They just want church to be the way that they're used to it being. They don't want anything to change. They want to remain steadfast in their traditions and attend a church that makes them feel comfortable. But they don't know God's church. They don't know God's church because they don't know God. God wants us to see him and to know him, so he purposely designed the church so man could know and understand him. The church is so much bigger than we perceive it. It's much more than intricate and supernaturally designed than we know, because hand in hand with the Bible, the church is the primary tool that God has created to reveal himself to us. God has given us a picture in the design of the church to lead us from where we are to where he is. That journey begins with the Bible. The Bible is our instruction manual. We have to trust the Bible. If you don't trust the Bible, you're already in trouble. We have to trust the information and the instruction that God has given to us in the Bible, that they are infallibly perfect because they are the words of our infallibly perfect God. You can't doubt anything in this book and then get from this book what God intends for you to know and understand. You can't pick it apart and pick and choose what you agree with and interpret it the way you want to please yourself and get from it the wisdom that it imparts. Rule number one, God's word is infallibly perfect. Rule number two, if you think God's word is wrong, refer to rule number one. I've come to the conclusion that not only those who are outside of the church, but even those who are inside of the church are horribly ignorant of the word of God. They don't know the Bible at all, but they think they're experts. It's amazing to me how many people will fight to defend their beliefs without the smallest shred of truth or evidence. Has anybody ever tried to convince you of something, but they didn't have the first clue as to what they were talking about? Are you a doctor? No, but I stayed at a Holiday Inn Express last night. Do you know your Bible? No, but I did attend church once and I have an opinion. There's some things that you have to know before you can understand anything else.
I want you to know that if you are searching for God's truth, if you're searching for real truth, the truth of God and His Word will always rise to the top. Jesus said in Matthew 7:7, ask and it'll be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you, because everybody who asks receives, everyone who seeks finds, and everyone who knocks the door will be opened. God wants you to know the truth, but the real question is, how bad do you want to know the truth? You see, our problem is sometimes we want to be lied to. We'd rather be fooled. We want to feel good about being bad. We don't want anybody to mess up our comfort zone or alter our preconceived notion of our self-made God. And when somebody does, we come all unglued. I run into this all of the time. My youngest son, Jacob, some of my boys, ugly, aren't they? That's what you get for sitting up front. My youngest, Jacob, has a tendency from time to time to post things on Facebook that are a bit controversial. Yeah, you've read his posts. And when he does, I get beat up. I really wish he'd stop doing that. Jimmy would tell, Dad, Jacob's done it again. Here we go, you know. About 5 or 6 years ago, he made a statement on Facebook. His original statement was this. He says, sorry to burst some bubbles, but purgatory isn't mentioned in the Bible because, C-U-Z, because it's not real. Now, I'm not sure, but I think that there might be some people outside of the church that don't like us. I think there are some people who smile to our face and then talk about us behind our back. I think that we're probably the topic of conversation at the bar and at the Legion and maybe even the Masonic Temple. I think that our name might be mentioned at the coffee shop and the gas station and the beauty parlor and maybe even some other churches. I'm not sure, but I think there might be one or two people out there who don't like us. But you know what? They don't know us. They don't know us. They have never been in our building. They have never heard me preach, but they have heard stories. Somebody said, somebody heard, they've heard stories that have been made up and embellished so many times, they ought to begin with the words, once upon a time. They don't know us, so they misjudge us. You see where I'm going? Jacob's statement started a firestorm. There were over 100 comments, many of which weren't very kind. There were grown adults taking shots at my teenage son, making wise remarks directed at Jimmy, firing shots at our church. One fella said, why don't we just all get our W-2s and go to Fry's church for a good $20,000 brainwashing? I have no idea what he was talking about or what it had to do with Jacob's original statement about purgatory. When you're in a bait and you leave the topic to take personal shots at the other person, it's a sure sign that you're losing your argument. Defend your church. Stand up for your church. Why? Because your church represents God's church. And if your church isn't a true representation of God's church, then you need to leave your church and find one that is. Be wise enough in the Word of God that you can defend your faith, and don't apologize when some misinformed individual doesn't agree with you or when it makes somebody angry. The truth is still the truth, and it will always be the truth. In John 8:31, Jesus said, if you hold my teaching, you are really my disciples, and then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The truth is still the only thing that will set people free. Some people today are afraid to think. They don't want to formulate an argument for what they believe. They know what they believe, but they just don't want to have to know why they believe it. I used to think that they were just lazy, but honestly, I believe it's fear. It's fear of the truth, fear of the facts, fear of reality. We are willingly and purposely ignorant of spiritual things, and so we don't understand sin. We don't understand the curse. We don't understand salvation. We don't understand heaven and hell, and we don't understand God because we don't know the Word of God. We are purposely, intentionally, and willingly ignorant of the Scriptures because we don't want a real and personal God to interfere with our perfect setup. We have it all figured out. We'll live like we want. We'll sin when we choose. We'll be uncommitted and uninvolved, but when it's all said and done, we'll still be pardoned and spend eternity in heaven. If that's what you believe, then you better put on your Kevlar underwear because you're on a fast lane to hell, not purgatory. God's church is holy ground. You might think of this place as just a building made out of steel and stone. You might see it as a man-made structure sitting in the middle of an old cornfield. But I want you to know that when the presence of God enters, it becomes holy ground. We are standing on holy ground. When you come in here, your shoes carried on them the evidence of where you have been. You've tracked in the sins you stepped in this past week, the evidence of the places that you've gone that you shouldn't have gone to. But this is God's house, and like God told Moses, you need to take off your shoes because the ground that you're standing on is holy ground. We are not worthy to enter here. We're not worthy to enter into God's presence. Somewhere along the line, we've come to believe that approaching God is a casual thing. We avoid the protocol. When we pray like the village idiot, we barge into the throne room barking out our demands to God. And then when we don't get what we want, when we want it, we criticize God for not being who he promised to be, and we scowl at him for letting us down. We enter the presence of God with sin on our record and evil in our heart, and then we have the audacity to make demands. We avoid the protocol, we crash the gate, we sidestep the altar, we omit the labor, and we trespass on holy ground, and then we have the audacity to complain when God's judgment falls. I want you to hear me today. There are consequences, and when you refuse to respect God's order. There are consequences when you sidestep God's rules and misquote God's words. There are consequences when you claim his name but refuse to live holy as he is holy. There are consequences when you attack his word and you attack his church. There are consequences when you bypass the blood and try to trespass on his holy presence. This is holy ground. To know God and to have that father-child relationship with him, we have to get close to him. You can't have an intimate relationship with anyone that you don't spend quality time with. But according to the scriptures, we can't get close to God until we've done four things. God, through the tabernacle of the Old Testament, has given us the images that we can see so he can reveal to us what otherwise would remain a great mystery. There are four things that we need to do to become intimate with God. Now, I know I've gone through this with you before, but I think it's necessary to keep doing it until we all grasp this truth. If you want to get near to God, if you want to see God and know God, if you want to really be saved, this is important. I'm telling you, your salvation is on the line. Don't be fooled by a little experience that you had. You need to examine your heart today and make sure you're really saved. Outside, around the tabernacle was a fence, and in the fence was a gate, the eastern gate. It was the only entrance into the courtyard of the tabernacle. There was only one way in, and that gate faced the east so that it would be illuminated in the morning by the sun, so everybody could see this is the way into God. The Bible is very clear that Jesus is the gate. Jesus said in John 14, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes in unto the Father except through me." God has illuminated the way to him, and that way goes only through Jesus Christ. It isn't through church membership, it's not through tradition, it's not through good works, it's not through any other religion or any other God. You can't enter any other way. You can only enter through Jesus. John 10 says, if you try any other way, you're like a thief and a robber. Just inside of the gate is the altar of sacrifice. You can't get around it. We can't avoid it, but if we want to move forward and get close to God, we have to deal with the altar of sacrifice. You can't enter into God's presence without sacrifice. You can't enter into God's presence empty-handed. Everybody has something to surrender. Everybody has a sacrifice to make, and we must all make the sacrifices that God asks for if we want to get close to him. In the modern church, we've done away with the altar of sacrifice. We surrender nothing. We sacrifice nothing. The idea of giving up something for God sounds ludicrous. So now we offer a cheap grace that promises all of God's benefits without any obligation of our own. A bargain basement salvation that costs us nothing. But that's not what the Word of God teaches. If you come in through the gate, you are going to face the altar of sacrifice. And there were five offerings that God said you're going to give me if you want to get near me. The burnt offering, the meal offering, the peace offering, the sin offering, the trespass offering. The burnt offering was for the general curse of sin.
For you and me, it's to acknowledge Christ's death on the cross for the sins of the world, the ultimate sacrifice that broke sin's curse once and for all. That's easy enough for us to do because we know that we're sinners. Everybody's sinners. Everybody knows everybody's a sinner. It is easy enough for us to recognize that Jesus died on the cross and that he rose again the third day. But then God gets personal. He asks for the meal offering, which is the sacrifice for our personal sin. For you and me, it's to admit to our own sins and seek God's forgiveness. I have to confess my own sin and seek God's forgiveness for the sins that are in my life. Once again, most of us are able to do that because we know we have personal sins in our life. And honestly, we like our record to be clean. We like our past to go away. And so we throw those sins on the altar. We say, God, go ahead and take those sins away. And he'll do that. But then it gets more difficult because God also requires the peace offering. And the peace offering is a sacrifice of submission. It's submitting to God in body and in spirit. Having acknowledged your sin and having recognized Christ's death as payment for your sin, you have to now surrender your life to God and become his servant. 1 Corinthians 15:31 says, Paul says, I die daily. My will is now lost in God's will for me. My plans are now God's plans. My will is God's will. God said, if you want to get anywhere near me, if you want to be saved, this has to go on the altar too. You see, this is where we start losing church people. They'll acknowledge that they're a sinner. They'll even acknowledge their own personal sin. But when it comes to giving God their all, they go, well, now wait a minute, that's a little bit too fanatical. And they pull back. Let me tell you something, if that's you, you are lost. You're as lost as you've ever been. You might have came in through the gate, but you are stuck at the altar. But still, God isn't finished. Being God's servant then requires the sin offering, which is a sacrifice of service. It is dedicating ourselves to God's service. It's working in his kingdom and for his kingdom. Whatever God commands me to do, I will do it. And lastly, there's a trespass offering. And this is the sacrifice of sanctification. It is holiness. It is the separating of ourselves from sin and from the world only unto God and becoming holy as he is holy. In the old church, we call it sanctification. That isn't something that happens after salvation. It's something that happens on your way in. The argument is made by some that all of the sacrifices offered on the altars were temporary and representative of the great sacrifice that Jesus would make. Many people believe that since Jesus died on Calvary, we don't have to sacrifice anymore. So we've thrown out the altar, and since the veil of the temple was torn apart at the death of Christ, then we just freely approach God without ever dealing with any of those things. We have it all figured out. But there are three scriptures that I want us to take a close look at, and they're from the New Testament. One of them is directly from Jesus himself. In Luke 9:23, says, he said to them, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever will save his life will lose it, and whoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. For what is a man advantaged if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Romans 12:1, he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Romans 8:13, for if you live after the flesh, you will die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify, what does that mean? Put it to death. Mortify the deeds of the body, you will live. You see, there are some things that you need to know before you can understand anything else. Salvation isn't an easy thing. Salvation is costly, and even though it's already been paid for, it's not cheap. But we've made salvation cheap. We've turned this priceless gift of God into a bargain basement closeout blue light special. Jesus gave his life in a horrific death. It wasn't pretty, sterilized scene, but when Jesus sacrificed himself, it was bloody, gory, and grotesque. But when Jesus died on the cross, it was also public. Everybody saw it. Everybody knew and everybody understood that Jesus had died on the cross. But we've devalued salvation. We've reduced salvation to a simple formula of kneeling and praying at an altar and then walking away. Very clean, very sterile. But true salvation is more than that. Real salvation is sacrifice of all that you've been, all that you've desired, and all that you've worked for, all your dreams, your hopes, your agenda, and your game plan for life in a very bloody public scene. You must not only die, but you must die publicly. Those who know you, those who are watching your life, must know that the old you, that old man or that woman that you used to be, is absolutely, positively dead. Can you honestly say that? As a pastor, I often fear that there are many good church-going people who will not pass the judgment of God. They've gone through the motions, they performed the rituals of their church, but they've never truly died on the altar with Christ. And because of that, they've never been in God's presence. They don't know Him. I fear that many will miss heaven someday, even though they attend church and give their money and they do good deeds and they participate in the rituals of the church. They have never truly died to God. There hasn't been that bloody public sacrifice of the person they once were. Instead, they leave a double life. There's the life they live when they're in God's house with God's people, but then there's the life they live when they're outside the outer wall and outside of the gate. Knowing God isn't an experience that you receive by making a trip to the altar of the church, but it is a relationship that you attain by submitting your entire life to God. The great, unseen, mysterious God of all wants to have a personal relationship with you. That's unfathomable. It's mind-blowing, but it's true, because the Bible says it's true. God has given to us the directions to a real relationship with Him. He's shown us how we can draw close to Him. But whether or not that relationship becomes a reality in our life is truly up to you and me. Real salvation is a real relationship with Jesus Christ. It is a blood-borne adoption into the family of God. He is our Father and we are His child. Do you really know God? Are you sure, really sure, that you're saved? If you're not sure that you know Him, or if you think that maybe hearing this, maybe I really don't know Him, I want to invite you to take a bold step forward and come and meet Him like I met Him. I knelt at the altar that whatever night that was, 14th night of revival. And there, my pastor introduced me to Him. And from that day forward, I've had a personal relationship. He's with me every day. I talk to Him every day. I hear from Him every day. When I do right, He blesses me. When I do wrong, He corrects me. But it's a real relationship. Father to Son. Abba, Father. If you don't have that today, I sincerely hope that you'll seek for it, because in that is true salvation. Father, bless these next moments. God, I don't know what you're doing in the hearts of the people that are out here. But God, I'm certain that there are some sitting in this church today who aren't really saved. Maybe they thought they were a Christian when they came in, but having heard the word, now they're questioning whether the relationship with you is a real one or not. Father, I pray that today, if we need to make some sacrifices, we will do that. God, if there are things that we need to surrender, we'll do that. God, we have to get close enough to you to find your salvation. And Father, I pray that we will take upon ourselves the responsibility that you require. God, that of a full surrender. Not a part-time, not a every once in a while, not when we feel good about it, but God, a full surrender that changes us, that crucifies that old person, and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that you'll save the soul that's nearest to hell today. And God, those who are holding on, that you'll pry loose and draw them to you. In Jesus' name.
Thank you for watching today's message from Free Christian Church of God in Continental Ohio. To find out more information about Free Christian Church of God, or to receive a copy of Reverend James Fry's weekly television program, Your Life, call the church office at area code 419-596-3103 or visit our website at freecog.org and download your copy today.